This is a problem to do some equilibrium calculations on a biological system. We're in the table, we're given equilibrium constants for a couple of proteins at different temperatures. And these are binding to the same DNA site. And we want to compare these by calculating the delta H for the reaction of binding and the delta S. And so a couple things to point out, very large equilibrium constants and a very narrow temperature range because of where we can operate with the proteins and not change them. And we also notice that as we raise the temperature for protein Q, the equilibrium constant increases. We raise the temperature for protein W, the equilibrium constant decreases. So that means that this reaction of protein Q with the DNA site is endothermic, and this one is exothermic. So to calculate the heat of reaction, we use the Van't Hoff equation, and this equation assumes that the heat of reaction is a constant. Because this is very narrow temperature range, it's actually a very good assumption. So in the form that we normally use it, the integrated form, it looks like so. And this relates equilibrium constant K2 at temperature T2, equilibrium constant K1, temperature T1, heat of reaction, the gas constant. So with just two data points, we could calculate delta H. If we want to be more accurate and use the three data points, we could use the form that this equation was derived from. And we should say at standard conditions, gas constant. And remember, this is the heat of reaction. So this says if I make a plot of the log of the equilibrium constant versus 1 over temperature, then I expect to have a straight line. So what I've done is create a table here where I repeated the temperature values and equilibrium constant. And then I just calculate the natural log of these equilibrium constants. And I calculate the inverse temperature, and I multiplied it by 10 to the third. So this is 1,000 divided by the temperature. And that's just to make it easier to display. So keep in mind, I got 3.57 by taking 1,000 divided by 7 plus 273 to make this absolute temperature. And that's critical that this is in Kelvin. So what I've done then is on a spreadsheet, have a plot, enter the values, and have a plot log of K versus inverse temperature. So I can get an equation from a least squares fit. And this is a comma here, 3,730 over absolute temperature plus 33.2. So this is a fit that, of course, from our equation of how log of K changes with inverse temperature means that 33,730 is equal to delta H of reaction, standard conditions, divided by the gas constant. And 33.2 is equal to delta S, standard conditions for the reaction, divided by R. And this results, if we look at the equations, remember delta G is delta H minus delta TS, and so then naturally follows from that to show that the intercept is delta S. So let's look at this. The log of the equilibrium constant is related to minus delta G standard conditions over RT. And delta G from our definition, so delta H minus delta TS over RT. If we're evaluating this at a temperature, so we have some equilibrium constant, you know, at 280 Kelvin, for example, then minus delta H over R, 1 over T, and plus, so T now is the given value, delta S over R. And this then is the intercept. This was the slope. And so delta H, then I minus sign here, so this ends being positive, positive sign here. So entropy change is positive. Delta H is positive, as we expected, right? Endothermic reaction. Entropy change is positive, even though we're binding a protein to a site, so other things must be happening. The shape of the protein is changing. Water molecules are released, so that delta S is positive. So I've just made the substitution for the values to calculate delta H reaction, 3730 times the gas constant. So 31 kilojoules per mole. And again, remember this is positive, so endothermic. So again, even though we're making chemical bond, you might expect that would be exothermic. We're forming a bond between these two molecules. Other things are happening. Overall, the reaction is endothermic. Well, no need to do the details of the calculation for the other protein, for protein W, right? This was for protein Q. I can just show the values, which corresponds to 29.8 kilojoules per mole. So for protein W, exothermic, and delta S from the intercept, 7.8. So that was delta S over R. So delta S is 64.8 joules per mole Kelvin. So one reaction is endothermic, the other is exothermic, and notice that the delta S change, and I guess I forgot to calculate, so let's look the delta S change. So the delta S change for, this is for protein Q, is much larger than for protein W. And that's necessary in the sense if you expect delta G, which is the driving force, to be negative. So let's do a quick comparison. So delta G at some temperature, and let's just pick 300 Kelvin. Remember delta G, T, delta S. So if we do this for each, and I'll just do the calculations. So I've just calculated delta G. So this is delta G for protein Q, delta H minus T delta S at, since I'm calculating 300 Kelvin. So it's negative, even though it's endothermic, because of the large entropy change. Delta G for protein W is also negative. It's because it's exothermic, even though it has a smaller entropy change. And notice the delta Gs are really quite similar and negative for both of these, but for quite different reasons. And so the changes with the binding, the entropy increases, even though we're binding a protein to DNA because of things like changes in conformation of the molecules, and also the potential release of bound water that would cause these significant entropy increases.